This is All India Radio. In the program Samvad, we now bring you a discussion on achievements of Ministry of External Affairs during the first year of NDA government's second term. The participants are strategic analysts Sandeep Dixit and Simran Sodhi.
Today we are discussing the highlights of the Ministry of External Affairs as it completes 1 year in the second term of the Narendra Modi government, and it had a number of highlights during this last year, and exemplary work has also been done by the Foreign Ministry. First, if we would talk about India's response to the COVID-19 pandemic worldwide, and that has also been listed at the top of achievements by the Ministry. Mr. Dixit, how do you look at the fact that the Ministry has very clearly set out that India has played a leading role globally in combating the COVID-19 pandemic, and this is something which adds India's clout globally?
A lot of countries have reached out to other countries depending on the national strength. And India, as we know, is the pharma capital of the world. So naturally, India was in the forefront of sending out HCQ tablets and powder, for instance, or paracetamol to over 100 countries. But if we divide the MEA's efforts, we will find that the MEA was one about sending medical supplies and sourcing critically required PPE and rapid testing kits from abroad during a time of international lockdown. The second was the massive repatriation effort it had made. And of course, the third that we are now discussing. All of these three efforts during COVID, it was a massive display of its institutional strength by the MEA. For instance, if we talk about medical supplies, we send them to over 154 countries, and that the world recognized that we were sending medical supplies when they were also needed for domestic consumption. So here was a time when India went out of its skin to help other countries in getting these medical supplies. At the same time, Indian diplomatic missions were at the forefront in trying to find out very, very quickly after the lockdown suppliers of PPE, suppliers of rapid testing kits, and then putting them in touch with Indian suppliers so that they could come to India in a very quick time. Since you've mentioned that India says it played a leading role, so it was not just in pharmacy where it played a leading role. There was virtual diplomacy that was going on during the COVID crisis. And at least 125 virtual diplomatic meetings of various levels were held.
As you pointed out, the repatriation, seeing that more than 3 lakh Indians who had been stranded in various parts of the world because travel restrictions imposed by the government as part of its lockdowns, they registered with various Indian missions abroad and to return home. And we've also seen the Vande Bharat mission and the special flights which have been operated by India to bring its nationals home. And it is also being hailed as one great success of the Ministry of Foreign Affairs. And we have also seen that this is under the leadership of Prime Minister Narendra Modi, where he has set a global example of how India has taken care of its people who are working or living or studying in various parts of the world.
Yeah, that is true. The Vande Bharat mission, which is into various phases, phase one got over with just 16,000 people brought in over 64 flights. But then we have seen this phase two, ongoing phase two, which is a much more bigger effort, where 1 lakh people will be brought in through naval ships, as well as flights and land borders which have been opened. But the government has indicated that there could be another effort, a bigger effort, phase three of Vande Bharat, which, as you have pointed out, that 3.4, 3.5 lakh people have registered with the Indian missions abroad. So that still leaves out 2.5 lakh people. And provided international flights do not start by then, we could be looking at MEA sustaining this massive humanitarian evacuation mission for maybe another month or so.
We've also seen that the MEA in the list it put out said that this is the corona era diplomacy which was activated, and this was a reference to Prime Minister Narendra Modi's video conference with leaders of the South Asian Association for Regional Cooperation, that is SAARC, where a special COVID-19 emergency fund was also created for South Asian nations. India contributed $10 million to the fund. How is this also an opportunity for India, as we discussed, not only to play a role globally, but also regionally, especially as we have seen that SAARC for the last few years, because of Pakistan's role in sponsoring cross-border terrorism, we saw that SAARC was not as active as it should have been, but we saw that the Prime Minister initiated this special COVID emergency fund, and he had a video conference with SAARC leaders, and we have also, in a way, India and the Prime Minister have been able to revive SAARC also in the process.
There are two things you've been touching upon. The first is that COVID-era diplomacy that has started And that COVID era diplomacy is of two types. One is the virtual video conferencing that is taking place, which means there's no need for face-to-face meetings. And the second COVID era, the type of diplomacy is about setting up a fund, about reaching out to its neighbors and other things. But when we talk of video conferencing in COVID era, there is actually no escape from face-to-face diplomacy. When an important Afghan event had to be discussed, then Zalmay Khalilzad, special envoy of the U.S. and Afghanistan, came physically to India and met External Affairs Minister and the National Security Advisor. Similarly, when Mike Pompeo had business with Israel, he went over to Israel recently and met its Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu. When the COVID era diplomacy is taking place, for instance, in the Australia-India virtual summit, the ground was actually laid in June, when PM had a bilateral meeting with Scott Morrison on the sidelines of the G20 summit. Similarly, a lot of groundwork had been laid before the pre-COVID era with a very energetic diplomacy that had gone on with External Affairs Minister, the Prime Minister, the Defense Minister and the Finance Minister. So that has facilitated this video conferencing because a lot of face-to-face interactions had happened earlier. The second is India put its best foot forward. As you rightly mentioned, that SAARC was reactivated even though Pakistan has been playing the truant country in it. And they went ahead with the SAARC fund. And hopefully this SAARC fund can be taken forward so that we have a SAARC R&D center somewhere which can then pool in resources from all the countries and take this SAARC thing forward. Similarly, India is also participating in worldwide funds also. One is the WHO fund, and the second is the fund that has been initiated by the British Prime Minister. So India has been inserting itself in COVID diplomacy that is happening all over the world in terms of producing vaccines, producing inoculation, extending its own medical capacity building. As you are aware, India sent a medical team to Kuwait, for instance, 15-member team that went there to train the nurses and doctors in how to handle COVID. So there are both these two aspects that have gone side by side, and they have to be taken forward because the first thing that we discussed was about video conferencing meetings through video conferencing. So perhaps a lot of that workload which used to be there earlier when ministers had to go personally, some of that at least can shift over to video conferencing, leaving the External Affairs Minister and the Prime Minister free to practice diplomacy with priority countries and not really try to extend yourself too much by physically traveling to those places. So there are both these two aspects that will play out in future.
Neighborhood first policy, whose initiation we saw in the first term, we have seen a very successful continuation in the second term. And see, we have seen that in this first year of the Modi II regime, we've also seen a very successful reach out to almost all South Asian nations, which also happen to be India's neighbors. This policy has also continued side by side, even though we have the COVID and we have the lockdown. How do you assess the success of the neighborhood first policy given the constraints that we are in today?
What we have seen is that, as you mentioned, that the neighborhood policy is a continuation of 5 years of Modi 1.0. Similarly, the neighborhood policy that we are witnessing today, 1 year down the line, is also a continuation right from the beginning. For instance, in May itself, last year after the government took over, there was an immediate meeting of the Terai Roads in Kathmandu. And that was co-chaired at a very high level. So, and then there was another meeting with Nepal on inundation and flood management, which is again of vital importance to the people of Nepal. And the Prime Minister made a state visit to Bhutan within 3 months of Modi 2.0 taking over. And there, as you have mentioned, a lot of business was transacted. And business also included the 720 megawatt Mangdechu hydroelectric plant, a futuristic ground earth station, and then inauguration of Bhutan's research and education network. And of course, the launch of RuPay cards in Bhutan then has seen launches in several other countries. So the neighborhood policy also was, as they say, the government start from the inauguration of Modi 2.0. It was concentrating on the neighborhood. And as you have very rightly mentioned, the presence of leaders over here at the swearing-in and the fact that Prime Minister Modi made it a point to visit as many as South Asian countries and neighboring countries as possible. So that has been one persisting element of Prime Minister Modi's neighborhood policy that has been going on. And in future also we will see perhaps a greater strength being imparted to this neighborhood policy, because we are on the cusp of a lot of breakthroughs in many areas with Bangladesh, with Sri Lanka, with Maldives, with the Seychelles, for instance, a bit further away. And then, of course, we have to mention Afghanistan, where the Chabahar port has become operational and 50,000 tons of wheat has been sent as COVID assistance for Afghan people, which should earn a lot of goodwill for India. And similarly, we have been reaching out consistently to all the SAARC countries to help them with our medical expertise. You heard about how Maldives got emergency medical supplies and how capacity addition in Maldives. So all these efforts, they are ongoing. But what we have seen that COVID provided a humanitarian face to all these initiatives. And that is what they say as soft power of India that was coming to the fore. India had that opportunity, and India has taken that opportunity to project its soft power to its neighbors, as opposed to, as you know, the hard power that is practiced by some other countries.
We also saw that in terms of global policy, the Ministry of External Affairs listed the elevation of ties with the United States. We also saw that India-US ties went up, and in terms of the cooperation as far as defense is concerned, space partnership, and we also saw the India-China informal summit happening in India. If we look at the elevation of ties with the United States and the personal chemistry which is shared between the Prime Minister and the U.S. President, we also see an indication of this in the recent statement made by U.S. President Trump, where he has said that India should become a part of G7 and the present G7 is no longer representative of the world order. So is this then a success of both India and Prime Minister Modi's leadership that we are today seen as one global player and we deserve a seat at very major international forums, including the G7?
Yes, in fact, since you mentioned G7, that is very interesting. Once upon a time, if you remember, it was G8, and they used to invite G5 countries, which is China, India, Brazil, South Africa, and one more. And they were invited for 5 years. Then Prime Minister Manmohan Singh attended 5 successive G8 summits as members of the G5. Now, 10 years later, what we see, China is out, South Africa is out, Brazil is out. India is the only surviving member of that 2005 to 2009 proposal of a G5 that used to be sit with G8. So what we see is that in the last 20 years, Russia got thrown out of G8. Other countries lost salience. India was the only country which got consistently invited to G7. And now Donald Trump has mooted India, Australia, South Korea, and Russia into an expanded G7. So what we find is that India is the only consistent element of the last 20 years. Prime Minister Modi goes to attend the G7 summit in September as proposed by Mr. Donald Trump. This will be the second successive G7 summit he will be attending. So one can easily calculate the India's salience in recent years on the global high stage. And as you are aware, India will be going into the UN Security Council January 1 next year, and then it will be hosting the G20 summit also. So there's a lot of India's presence on the global high stage has been a lot more visible and will be a lot more visible in the coming years because of the efforts that have been made in the previous years to strike up much deeper, much content-driven bilateral partnerships, which are now showing results in the form of India being regarded as one of the leading countries that needs to be brought to be invited to the global high table, which needs to attend the global high table and share its experience with other countries.
So we see that the first year in the Foreign Affairs Ministry in the second term of the Narendra Modi government has had many achievements and many highlights, as we have discussed some of them. And we look forward to the next years where we can continue our discussions on these topics. Thank you.
Thank you.
You were listening to a discussion on achievements of Ministry of External Affairs during the first year NDA government's second term. The participants were strategic analysts Sandeep Dixit and Simran Sodhi. This program was produced and presented by the News Services Division of All India Radio. You can listen to it on our mobile app, News on AIR. This program is also available on our website, newsonair.com. You may email your opinion about this program at airnsdtalks@gmail.com.